last talk of the day is Jared Speck from MIT with us about finite-time degeneration of hyperbolicity.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. I realize that many of you are not wave people, so I picked a topic that I thought would be accessible even to non-experts in wave people. So it's accessible on the one hand, I believe, but on the other hand, the results are brand new. They're the first of their kind, and I think there are many interesting opening problems. Okay, so model equations. So almost everything that I say today will take place in the setting of three spatial dimensions. So specifically R, 1 plus 3. And let me write down some model metrics. So the metrics I'm most interested in look like this, relative to the usual flat coordinates on R, 1 plus 3. Psi is an unknown, but we'll eventually solve an equation. And then here is just the usual flat Euclidean metric on R3. P is an exponent, and I'm only going to consider two cases, so P will be 1 or 2. All right, so I want to look at the following wave equation. This is a quasi-linear wave equation. So let me break the convention of geometry and call the inverse of G by G inverse instead of G. D alpha, D beta, psi is 0. Okay, and clearly the metric depends on psi. Sorry, this should be minus. Very important. So if I write this out in the flat coordinates, this is just the following wave equation. 1 plus psi to the p, the plus of psi is 0. Okay. If not for this factor of psi, this would just be the usual linear wave equation. Okay, so let me just talk about, very quickly, the well-posedness theory for this equation. Just the basic well-posedness theory. That is to say, solving the Cauchy problem locally in time. So let's take initial conditions, psi and dt psi, at time 0, so let me call sigma t the flat hypersurface of constant time. So I'm giving conditions along sigma 0. And let me call the initial data for psi, let me call it by psi rank. And for dt psi, let me call it psi naught with a ring. And let me just put them in a standard Sobolev space. Let's say HS of sigma naught cross HS minus 1 sigma naught. Okay. Then here's the usual theorem that you'll find in many papers and many books. Local well-posedness theorem. Well-posedness plus what's called continuation criteria. So let me tailor everything to the case of three space dimensions. So, and let's say integer valued choices of S. So if S is at least S naught, let's say 3, then there exists a time greater than 0, such that solution exists on space-time slab. And the regularity of the solution is, the regularity of the initial data are propagated by the solution for at least this amount of time. So let me just talk about psi. Psi is a continuous map from the time interval 0t into the Sobolev space HS. So this is just an existence statement. And then the continuation says that solution can be continued. Basically, as long as some L1 type norm of the first derivative of the metric doesn't blow up. So as long as, it can be continued past time t. As long as the following integral is finite. So 0 to t, the first less than or equal to one derivatives of the solution at time s in L infinity with respect to the x variable ds. Okay, so this statement is that the only way the solution can blow up is that this L infinity norm with respect to space, if you integrate it in time, must blow up. So the only way a singularity can form is if this blows up. The time of existence, t, can be chosen to depend on the S not Sobolev norm of the data. Psi not the data in the norm HS not, and psi not two knots. So psi not. H S not minus one. Okay. So these are very classical results in wave equations that one can prove using only energy estimates and Sobolev embedding. Those are basically the only two ingredients you need. And so why did I write this theorem down? I wrote it down because it's false. Okay? Because you read the statement in many places and there's always an implicit assumption. And today is totally about that implicit assumption. So what hasn't been stressed, or put differently, the correct, precise statement of this theorem absolutely must account for the fact that the metric remains an honest-to-God Lorentzian metric. Okay? So what can go wrong, and what is totally not accounted for in this theorem, is that this coefficient can vanish in finite time. This coefficient can go to zero. And in the case, let's say p equals 1. In the case p equals 1, what can happen in principle is that the coefficient actually passes through zero and heads into territory where it becomes negative, in which case the equation becomes elliptic and it's no longer even a wave equation. And there's no hope of this theorem being true. You know, as soon as you have an elliptic PDE, there's no hope of a theorem like this, because the Cauchy problem for an elliptic PDE is ill-posed in Sobolev spaces. Okay, so what I'm going to outline for you over the course of the next two lectures is a proof that for these equations, there is an open set of data, so that the coefficient vanishes in finite time. Okay, so for the set of initial data I'm going to talk about, psi is going to basically start off near zero, but the coefficient will vanish in finite time. And there's basically not going to be any singularity in the solution. So you're not going to see any singularity of any kind. It's just going to be a vanishing of the coefficient. On the other hand, if you look at the curvature of the metric, if you think of this Lorentzian metric, and you look at the Kretschmann scalar, which depends, okay, of course, less than or equal to two derivatives of the solution. If you look at the Kretschmann scalar, this is going to blow up. So there's going to be a curvature singularity, even though there's no singularity in the solution. And there are going to be interesting implications for this. Okay, so let me give a little bit of context about my interest in the study of this kind of degenerate behavior. So, like I mentioned, this is the first result of its kind in more than one space dimension. The vanishing of this coefficient with everything remaining bounded. And I'm very interested in the question of whether or not you can extend this beyond model equations to see this happening in real physical equations. Okay, so at this point, it's not well understood, because not very much at all is well understood. So, compared to our understanding of global existence for wave equations, so by global existence I mean for a large set of equations, if the initial data are sufficiently small, then the solution will be global, and this kind of degenerate thing that I just mentioned, this coefficient vanishing in finite time, doesn't happen. Okay? We have a very advanced, though certainly not complete, understanding of global existence results for wave equations. Much less is known about degeneracy. Okay, so the study of blow-up and vanishing of coefficients and all sorts of other bad things that can happen in quasi-linear equations is way less advanced than the theory of global existence. So let me just give you, I don't mean for this to be the complete story, but I'm going to write down a summary of a lot of what we know about blow-up and degeneracy in quasi-linear and semi-linear wave equations. Okay, this is not the whole story, but it's a huge chunk of the story. I'm going to tell you almost everything we know. Okay, so what can go wrong for non-linear wave equations? What can go wrong in solutions to non-linear wave equations? So let me first talk about scalar equations, or more generally, wave map type systems that look like this. Box psi is some function of psi. So here, box is the flat wave operator. Box m is the usual flat wave operator associated to the Minkowski metric. Okay. So for certain choices of f, there are many spectacular results for what can go wrong with the solution. Okay, there's a whole group of extremely strong people that work on just this semi-linear kind of equation. So usually when you see blow up, it's somehow due to something like focusing on nonlinearity. That means f of psi somehow has the sign that when you pair it with the minus dt squared psi on the left-hand side, suggests blow up by the usual ODE type picture. So, you know, something like minus psi to the fifth. so there are lots of people. Let me just say some names out loud. Koenig, Krieger, Martel, Merle, Raphael, Schlug, Sturvin, Chaptel. A lot of good people have worked on the blow-up theory for these kinds of equations. And one idea that you'll often heard tossed in the air concerning these equations is that people like to study them because they believe that they will yield insight into more interesting equations, like quasi-linear equations that one encounters in fluid mechanics, general relativity, elasticity. So these are often advertised as model problems for what can go wrong in quasi-linear theory. Okay. Now, though there are some spectacular mathematical advances that have come out of the system of study of these kinds of equations, I'm personally a bit skeptical of the claim that they can tell you that they give useful information for what goes wrong in the quasi-linear world. So, for example, for semi-linear equations, you can never have this situation coming up, right? Or at least for when the wave operator is boxed down, you never have vanishing of the principal coefficients. Okay. Moreover, if you look at the techniques that go into the study of this wave equation, they are essentially totally inapplicable to quasi-linear equations. So what do you have in this world? You have there's a conserved energy. So you can often take advantage of scaling arguments. So often equations like this, f of psi to psi to the p, exhibit good scaling properties. And there are very fancy techniques that take advantage of this kind of thing. And you have fancy arguments like channel of energy arguments, which basically says that you can prove that part of the solution propagates at exactly the wave speed you think it would propagate at, you know, somehow like a very, very, very sharp version of Huygens' principle. And there's actually an enormous list of techniques that have been applied to these kinds of equations, and basically none of them seem to have anything to do with the quasi-linear world. Okay. All right. So this is certainly the most advanced, for these class of wave equations, the theory of singularity formation is most advanced. Okay. So let me jump to shock waves. So the first results concern equations that look like this. So G is some Lorentzian metric that depends on d phi. And d phi solved a homogeneous wave equation that looks like this. And so you have to make some tensorial structural assumptions on the behavior of the nonlinear term. I'm not going to get into the details, but it can be summarized by the failure of the famous null condition of Sergio Kleinerman. So if the null condition fails, this means that certain resonant interactions are present in the equation. So then, Sergio Alinek, late 1990s, early 2000s, and a series of absolutely remarkable papers proved that there is a set of small data, so exists small data, such that, okay, and all of these results I'm talking about on this board, this kind of degeneracy where the coefficient vanishes does not occur. Okay, so none of these results, what's going wrong in the solution is not the vanishing of a coefficient, it's something else. There exists small data such that, two derivatives blow up in finite time. But phi and d phi remain bounded. So his work, I forgot to say, this is work in 2D and 3D. And though he didn't explicitly state it in his papers, all of the wave equations of compressible fluid mechanics with zero vorticity fall under the scope of his work. Okay, so this is called shocks, shock waves. Shock means that roughly some higher derivative of the solution blows up, but the solution itself doesn't. So shocks form in, irrotational fluid mechanics. I should say that the theory of shock formation in one space dimension is completely classical. It goes all the way back to at least Riemann. Okay, when Riemann invented the method of Riemann invariance, he was studying exactly this kind of singularity formation. Alignac's contribution was to do something in more than one space dimension. Okay, then in 2007, Chrysadoulou wrote this 1,000-page book. Let me call this these equations of type star. So he proved essentially the same result that Alignac did, but he dramatically sharpened it. Okay, dramatically sharpened it. So sharpened Alignac's result, but not for the full class of equations. For the Euler-Lagrange equations of irrotational fluid mechanics. Okay, so there was an Euler-Lagrange structure to the equations that Quasilinear studied, and they ended up being really important for his proof. So I won't get into the full details of what he did that was sharper, but I'll just mention some of the main ideas. First of all, he gave what you could call an absolute complete description of the solution, complete description of the blow-up. I told you basically everything you want to know about the singularity. In such a way that he set up the problem, hasn't been solved yet, but he set it up, of continuing past the singularity. So that's a major open problem, not just in wave equations, but in more generally in the field of nonlinear hyperbolic conservation laws. It's well known from one space dimensional theory that shocks form, and we want to continue past them. Okay, we want to weakly continue the solution, and right now there's only a 1D theory. There's only a 1D theory, there's nothing in 3D, or 2D. Okay. But even setting up the problem, properly setting up the problem, requires a very, very sharp description of the dynamics. Okay, and he showed something else remarkable. For small initial conditions, so shocks are the only kinds of singularities possible. Nothing else can go wrong. Okay. So, this 1,000-page book took some time for the community to digest, but there's some follow-up work now. Okay, so I'm one of the people who did some follow-up work, so So this is my book. It'll be published about 2 weeks, actually. It's an AMS monographs and surveys series book. So let me call this 3. This will be 3A. Christodoulou's results. Hold for all of Allen X equations. So in other words, you don't need the Euler-Lagrange structure to get the same sharp picture. So 3B, this is crucial. Same result for divergence form wave equations for things that look like this, E alpha, G inverse, alpha beta. So here, instead of depending on the derivative of the unknown, the metric depends on psi itself, the unknown itself. This is metric lives at a different level of dependence on the unknown. And you could actually put some right-hand side here. So there is some right-hand side that's allowable, but it's a little bit hard to say exactly what kind of terms are allowed on the right-hand side, so I'm not going to get into that. And so 4 is a more follow-up work by various people. On Christodoulou's approach to different equations and sets of initial conditions of data. 5 or 6 works. So for example, Jonathan, Luke, and I. We were able to understand shock formation in fluid mechanics with vorticity. So there's when you have a fluid with vorticity, there's a transport equation involved where the vorticity is being transported, so shocks with vorticity. Okay. So for these, this should be called 4. So for these quasi-linear equations, the theory of formation of shockwaves is becoming more and more advanced. Right? We really know an awful lot about them. And so now I come to the last, effectively the last kind of equation for which something is known. So these are back to the semi-linear case. So let me, box phi is, let me put the focusing sign. So minus dt phi is good. Okay. Yeah. If you look at solutions that don't depend on x variable at all, this is just in the ODE case. This just becomes, if you call y, if you set y equals dt phi, then in the ODE case, it just becomes y dot equals y squared. Because this is the famous Riccati equation, which exhibits finite time blow up. Okay? So there is a result by Fritz John from the 80s, which is non-constructive. Okay, it's It's not so easy to say exactly how the proof works, but basically he constructs a complicated system of inequalities that lead to a proof of blowup by contradiction. And the theorem is, okay, his theorem applied to a large class of equations. I'm just focusing on this particular example. Zero is the only global solution. Okay, so why do I mention this? First of all, this is an important model equation because it's actually a better model for some of the kinds of nonlinear terms that we see in quasi-linear theories. So if you were going to have a debate about which model equations are more relevant for quasi-linear systems that come up in physics, then I would argue for studying these kinds of equations over these kinds of equations. But remarkably, the blow-up mechanism is not well understood at all. We don't really have a good understanding of why the solution blows up, or the blow-up rate, or the mechanism, or what goes wrong for this class of equations. The only thing we have, really, are the ODE blow-up picture, when the solution doesn't depend on space derivatives, and this proof of contradiction by Fritz John that says, well, something goes wrong, but we don't know what. So that's very weird because you know, everything else equal, you might think that the semilinear equations should be easier to study than quasilinear equations. But that's not the state of the art. The state of the art is that we understand quasilinear blowup, at least for these classes of equations. We understand quasilinear blowup much better than the semilinear blowup picture. Okay. So. as I mentioned, though this is not a complete survey of what's known about degeneracy for wave equations, this is a really, really good overview of the kinds of things that can go that are known to go wrong in solutions to various nonlinear wave equations. Okay, so the result that I'm going to talk about today and tomorrow is. Somehow adding to the picture of what can go wrong in the quasi-linear world. Okay, the coefficients can vanish. Okay. All right. Okay. So. So now I'm going to give a slightly more detailed statement of the main result. And then we're going to start talking about elements of the proof. And along the way, I'll mention various things that are known about semi-linear relatives of this equation, and various open problems associated to the analysis of these kinds of equations. Okay, so for technical reasons, this is probably not sharp, but it's certainly convenient. I'm going to take initial data in H6 cross H5. Okay, it's just a convenient space for the kinds of estimates that I want to talk about. So here's the theorem. So it exists open set of data. Open in this topology. Such that the space derivatives of the solution
are initially small.
Maybe I should say not just the space derivative, such that psi itself and its are initially small. With respect to, so two things. So the smallness is actually a non-linear kind of smallness, and we'll talk about that later in the proof when that non-linear assumption becomes relevant. It has to be small with respect to what? So you take the L infinity norm of the time derivative data. Dt psi at time zero, and this is a crucial assumption, and it has the assumption I'm about to write has connections to many other interesting problems in wave equations, including the shock formation problems that I mentioned earlier. Okay, so what is this assumption? You take the initial time derivative. You look at its negative part. So by definition, for me, this is a positive quantity, or a non-negative quantity. You look at its negative part, and you take the soup, right? Take the soup. Over the initial data slice. So what you're implementing, essentially, is that the time derivative of psi should be initially pretty negative in comparison to the space derivative term. Okay. Of course, you can probably guess why you would want to oppose that if you're trying to prove a result like this. If you put the time derivative of psi to be, you know, negative, like, okay, let's exaggerate a little bit, negative 1, then if the time derivative is negative 1, and space derivatives don't matter, so you can, you know, forget about this term because this is supposed to be small. Then, if you can somehow prove all that, then this becomes essentially an ODE. Right? This basically says two time derivatives of psi is zero. So that means dt psi doesn't change very much. So if it's initially very negative, it will stay negative. And it will drive psi to zero in finite time. Okay, so that's the picture. I mean, that's the very crude picture. You just take a situation where you try to treat the wave equation like an ODE. Okay. So these are the kinds of smallness conditions that one needs. So under these conditions, under these conditions, there exists a time positive time such that 1 plus psi vanishes for the first time precisely at t star. Coefficient goes to zero, and you have the following regularity properties. Okay, so there are quite a few of them. Let me just state some of the more interesting ones. Okay. So if you stop short of the time of degeneracy, you don't go all the way to T star, but you leave the right endpoint open, then you get a continuous map into exactly the space you started with. You started in the Sobolev space H6, and you stay in the Sobolev space H6. But the estimates don't allow you to go all the way up to time T star. Instead, and this is a critical part of the proof, one one can prove is L1 in time bound. You can go all the way to the endpoint. Okay. In H6, if you integrate in time. Okay. So that means the H6 norm can blow up at time t star, but somehow the time integral of it doesn't. And okay, another statement. If you are willing to drop below the top derivative level, if you go below H6, like for example, go to H5, then you can go all the way to time t star, including the endpoint, without leaving the Sobolev space H5. Okay. So you, it's continuous all the on the closed interval 0 t star with values in the Sobolev space H5. So, and you can say something about the Kretschmann scalar. The Kretschmann scalar of this metric behaves like, what are these? In fact, it's asymptotic to some constant times. So this will this will essentially tell you why the Kretschmann scalar blows up. Let me find the precise statement. Precise power, like dt psi to the fourth over 1 plus psi to the fourth. Okay. So there is some critically important monotonicity built into the setup here. And it's an essential part of the proof, which you'll see in great detail. A key point is that at points where 1 plus psi vanishes, that is where the denominator goes to 0, you have a quantitative estimate about the numerator, dt psi. Okay? So for the class of solutions that I'm talking about, 1 plus psi goes to 0 precisely because dt psi is lower bounded in magnitude with a strict negative sign. Okay, so that means that this quantity really does blow up at the points where 1 plus psi goes to 0. Okay, the top is positive and the bottom goes to 0. Okay. this is a... Okay, for me, I study, among other things, the geometric wave equations. This... result comes with an interesting moral lesson, which is that curvature blow-up doesn't have to be tied to singularity in the solution variable itself. Okay, so in general relativity, of course, the metric is the unknown. So blow-up of the curvature, in a sense, is blow-up for the solution. But for other equations, you know, you can have curvature blow-up without having a singularity in the solution. So, yes, please, question.
Actually, the curvature within the C is up and down. What expression is that exactly?
So this is just the Kretschmann scalar formed from the Riemann curvature tensor that you construct out of this metric. Right? So this is a metric. Mm-hmm. So it is some little Lorentzian metric. You can write down its curvature tensor. In principle, okay, it's a bit ugly, but one can do it.
Yeah.
And compute the Kretschmann scalar, right? And so the Kretschmann scalar depends on two derivatives of the metric. True derivatives of the metric depends on two derivatives of the solution. And the main term, as it turns out, is not two derivatives of the solution, but it's one derivative of the solution. All the other terms that you would expect to contribute are small compared to the main term. They're small for two reasons. Number one is that they're space derivative terms, which you've put that kind of smallness into the problem because you're taking small space derivatives. The other kind of smallness you can have are two time derivatives, which are equal to two space derivatives. Okay? So basically all of the error terms are either space derivatives or two time derivatives. Okay.
Sorry. Is there a bound for t star? Like when this t star is going
out? It's very sharp, yeah. So that's actually, so part of the proof is guessing the time of first degeneracy,
giving yourself a little bit of margin of error, and then validating your guess. So it's a big bootstrap proof. And the idea is very simple, so we'll revisit it at the appropriate time of the proof. But the idea is just, you know, treat this like an ODE. If you do that, then, you know, you just solve for, you solve for psi, right? And with the right initial conditions, psi will go to zero in the amount of time predicted by the ODE. And then if the space derivatives are small and you can propagate that, then the time will, of true vanishing will just be a small perturbation of that. Okay. Is there any questions so far? Remind me when I'm supposed to stop.
5.
All right. So, okay. So, let me make some preliminary remarks on the proof, because I want to point out some connections with some of the other problems. The main, okay, so there are lots of things one has to do in this problem, but for quasi-linear equations, there's a meta-theorem, which has been rigorously proved in some cases, but I don't think it's been proved in full generality. The meta-theorem basically says the only kind of estimates that you can hope to propagate for quasi-linear wave equations are, at least at the top order, L2 based. Okay? So basically, the only kind of norms of the initial data that we know how to propagate are L2 in nature. So that means you're stuck doing energy estimates for these kinds of equations, at least at the top order, that's all we know how to do. Okay, so that means a crucial ingredient in the proof is going to be the energy estimates. And let me, for most of the discussions, restrict my attention to the case P equals 1. Okay. The case P equals 2 can be treated using almost the same ideas, but it's a little bit cumbersome to try to do both cases at the same time. So, so here is the energy that I use. And to appreciate this, we're going to have to talk a little bit about the construction of the initial data. So the energy that I'm going to use to control the solutions is such that you have to commute the wave equation with space derivatives at least 2 times and no more than 5 times. Okay, so that's a technical thing. To appreciate it, we'll take a look at the kinds of initial data. And it will also, the structure of the energy will also show you the main difficulty in the problem. So you integrate over the constant time flat hypersurface sigma t, and here I'm going to sum. K prime goes from 2 to 5 of the time derivative of K prime space derivatives. So for me, nadla means you take a spatial gradient. You can think of this as a flat covariant derivative if you want, of psi squared plus, and here comes the difficulty. So not surprisingly, when you go to do standard energy estimates for this equation, your expression is going to pick up this weight, which degenerates as the coefficient goes to zero. So you should be expecting to see exactly this weight, 1 plus psi. Remember, p is 1. If p were 2, this would be power p. And then here you have the gradient of grad k prime psi squared. And then it's very convenient to throw in a lower order term where there are no derivatives on grad k prime psi. And this is an integral with respect to the flat volume form of Euclidean space. Okay. All right. So here's the here's the difficulty. So this is the energy. So to sort of sketch why this analysis requires some careful treatment, let's take k derivatives of this equation and see what kind of terms we can get. Okay, so let me just write one of the top order terms. We'll take a look at this analysis in detail in the coming minutes. Here I just want to sort of prime you for what's to come. So let's take that equation and pass k prime spatial derivatives through it. So how did I write it? Psi plus 1 plus psi. Laplacian grad k prime psi equals, now to the extent possible, I'm going to write everything very schematically because the precise numerical constants and so forth don't really matter for this kind of problem where you're giving yourself smallness. So what's the most difficult term you can get? Well, when one derivative falls on psi and all the rest of them fall on Laplacian psi, that's the kind of error term you can pick up on the right-hand side. Something like this. So and if you count carefully, that would be k prime plus 1 derivatives falling on the remaining term. Okay, so this is somehow the worst product you can imagine. You pass k prime derivatives through this equation. One of them falls on this term. All the rest fall on this guy, and you put that on the right-hand side. All right? Now, if you're in a situation where you're trying to prove that this guy is small, okay, let's put ourselves in that situation. This is something you have to prove, of course, but let's imagine that we can prove it. Then this error term, let me call the smallness associated to this. Let me call it, suppose this is bounded in L infinity by size epsilon, okay? We're going to put that into some bootstrap assumptions later. Then you have something that looks like this. Grad k prime psi. Okay. So as we'll discuss, when you go to do energy estimates, so they're going to look something like this. The influence of this error term in the energy estimates will appear like this. So you write down some energy inequality, and you're going to try to apply Grönwald's inequality to it to get some bound on the energy. And the bound on the energy is supposed to give you these bounds. Okay. You try to apply Grönwald's inequality, and what you pick up from the usual energy argument is you pick up a time integral of the space integrals of the inhomogeneous terms. So grad. Let me even look at the worst case. Right. Let me put k prime equal to 5. Let's do the top order, the worst thing. Right. 5. Five space derivatives have been passed through the equation, and it gets multiplied, at least for this simple energy inequality, by dt of grad 5 psi b3. So this is a standard integration by parts argument. We'll talk about it a little bit more. Okay. Plus, a whole bunch of other terms that I haven't written, some of which are actually crucially important. Okay, so and remember, the goal is to control this back in terms of the energy by Grönwald's inequality. Okay, so if you try to do Cauchy-Schwarz on this guy, if you try to do Cauchy-Schwarz, then you'll pick up the square of this guy, dt grad 5. And that's fine, because that's one of the terms featured in your energy. Okay, so you can hope, you know, when you're doing this Grönwald argument, you're going to get back the energy itself on the right, which is going to lead to possible exponential growth in time of the energy, but that's okay. if you give yourself very small data. Okay. The energies that we're going to construct are going to be are going to inherit this smallness. Okay, so in fact, that's why it's a good idea to start with two. From scaling considerations, you'll see that starting with two derivatives will enable you to inherit the smallness of the data into the energies. And you should think you're just starting off, so this is going to be very small. And so what you're trying to do is construct a Grönwall argument so that the only thing the energies do is grow exponentially in time. If the time of degeneracy T star is not too large compared to the smallness, then you'll be able to close up. You'll be able to close this line of logic. Okay, so what you want to do is prove a regular Grönwall estimate for the energies, where nothing blows up. And if you try to Cauchy-Schwarz this term, you know, bounded by grad to the fifth psi squared plus dt grad to the fifth psi squared, you immediately see the problem. The problem is that this coefficient is going to zero. Okay? This coefficient is going to zero, and you have a term, you have an error term that doesn't have that small weight there. So, for example, imagine that this term, imagine that 1 plus psi were going to zero, like the final time. So imagine, I'm just trying to give you a schematic picture of why you should worry about that, of why you should worry about the lack of a weight here. Imagine that you had some behavior like this, that 1 plus psi was going to 0 like that. Okay. If that were the case, or even this would be bad, right? Even this would be bad. If that were the case, then when you go to apply Grönwall's inequality to this term, the discrepancy weight is going to be, you know, 1 over this. Okay? And when you Grönwall that, you're going to get a horrific estimate. If you applied Grönwall's inequality and this were somehow the best information you had available, you would prove that the energy blows up at some horrific rate. Okay, and you would never be able to close the smallness. You would never be able to follow the solution all the way to the degeneracy. You would never be able to prove anything. You would be forced to stop the analysis short of the time of degeneracy. You would be able to get close to it, but you wouldn't be able to go all the way. Okay, so what saves you in this problem are two things. The first of which, the main point, I haven't written yet. When you go to do the energy estimate, you pick up a term that is of critical importance. You pick up the term, some time integral t integral sigma s. So how do you go from this definition to here? One way to think about it is you take the time derivative of this energy, take ddt of it, and you use the wave equation to eliminate all of the highest derivative terms and substitute them with inhomogeneous terms, like this term. And then after you have an expression for time derivative of the energy, you integrate that expression in time to produce this kind of inequality. That's one way to think about this. So I phrased it in that particular way to point out that when you go to do this estimate, you will absolutely have a term where the time derivative falls on psi. Okay? When you take the time derivative of the energy for, you know, totally trivial reasons, you pick up a term where dt falls on psi. And it looks exactly like this. It's dt psi times, and it's on the right-hand side, that's really important, times grad of grad k prime psi squared dx. Okay. So this is the key point. The key point is that you're studying a solution regime where the only way psi can become small, or the only way this coefficient can start to become small is if dt psi is fairly negative. Okay? If you're at a fixed spatial point where dt psi is not too negative, then at that spatial point, the coefficient will not have had time to grow small. Okay? But if you're in a spatial point where the degeneracy is about to form, if this is about to become zero, it can only be doing that if this term is sufficiently negative. Okay? And you put that assumption into your initial data in a precise way. That means that in the region where this kind of degeneracy is threatening you, this term has a quantitative negative sign. This is a friction integral. Okay, it comes up with a friction sign. And because of this smallness here, this epsilon coming from the quadratic nature of the inhomogeneous term and the smallness on the space derivatives, because of this friction term, you can actually soak up this integral with an epsilon into this integral. Okay. And so somehow the same mechanism that's driving the degeneracy is also giving you a friction term in the energy estimates that allows you to sort of prove that this is actually happening. Okay, so that's like the big idea. So this same mechanism is found in many distinct contexts in the study of quasi-linear wave equations. So all of these shock formation results that I mentioned earlier, okay, they're actually much harder to prove, but they are all such that the energy estimates one proves have weights, and that the weights have negative time derivatives in the regions where the solution is hard to control. Okay, so that's one area where you see this kind of phenomenon coming up. Another interesting area is in general relativity, where, okay, don't really want to get into the details, but there are situations where you have what's called a redshift effect and a blueshift effect. And in the theory of wave equations on black hole backgrounds, some of the estimates are called redshift effect estimate or blueshift effect estimate. And basically all of these effects, at least in the study of wave equations, when you translate them into analysis, at the end of the day, they simply state that some term in the energy estimate has a favorable sign that acts like a friction term. Okay. So basically, in the study of quasi-linear wave equations, in general, if you're not in a regime where there's some kind of monotonicity of this type in the energy estimate weights, then we don't know how to prove anything. Okay. So this is a good time to mention that this kind of degeneracy of you have some wave-like equation and the coefficient is going to zero has been studied in one space dimension. So there's actually only one author I know who's addressed these kinds of problems. His name is Susan Mama. So he proved a similar kind of thing in 1D, where the method of Riemann invariance is available. That means no energy estimates. Everything reduces to ODEs in integrating along characteristics. And he had a proof by contradiction, so his proof was indirect. He found a quantity that blows up in finite time, and he showed that the only way that can happen is if the coefficient goes to zero. Okay. So between this result and this result, that is essentially all that's known about quasi-linear wave equations where you have coefficients that can vanish in finite time. If you look in his papers, So I haven't personally thought deeply enough about this. I intend to in the near future. But if you look in his papers, Sugiyama talks about physical equations, so equations from physics. Physical equations where the equation has the potential for this kind of degeneracy. Okay, so vaguely, his claim is that this kind of degeneracy should happen in real physical equations. Though, like I said, I haven't really investigated this in detail myself. One thing I want to point out, which I won't dwell on, but which is relevant for some of the equations that Sugiyama cites in his papers, is that these techniques are, they have some robust features. The specific algebraic form of this equation is not that important, and the fact that the right-hand side was zero also wasn't that important. For example, I could essentially prove the same result if I put a term that was some function of psi, not necessarily vanishing at psi equals zero, times two space derivatives of psi. Okay, so strictly speaking, the equations that Sugiyama talks about in this paper are not homogeneous, but they have these psi times d psi squared terms in them. But from the point, if you just take a look at the kinds of inhomogeneous terms that you would generate from those kinds of nonlinear terms, you would basically get terms of the same kind that I've already written here. Okay? And for me, that's philosophically very important because if you want to apply, if you want to try to approach realistic physical problems, it's absolutely to your advantage to have techniques that are as robust as possible. So if somehow these results were relying on, algebraic tricks that only work for one nonlinearity, then I think that I would be not very interested in them. Okay. So these are the main issues to be understood. Let me also point out that the L1 control, so here I said at the top order, the only thing I know how to prove that holds all the way up to T star is this L1 and time bound of the top derivative of the solution, okay? And it exactly comes from this term, right? If this term has a negative sign, let's say, for sake of discussion, let's just put dt psi equals negative 1. Then you can bring this term back over to the left, right? And this gives you an additional space-time integral on the left-hand side, the friction integral, that controls up to a gradient of 5 derivatives of psi, so 6 derivatives of psi, integrated once in time. And that is exactly the term in box there. Okay, so that's where it comes from. Any questions? Okay, so basically in the remainder of the lectures, I'm going to totally go through the proof with you and talk about some interesting directions that one might want to head in, because essentially every single interesting question I can think of that has something to do with this is wide open. Okay, so let's start talking in detail about the assumptions on the initial conditions. And at the same time, why there should exist such initial data. Data assumptions. Okay, so I just want to consider the simplest possible setup, so I'm going to use the crudest norms I can possibly come up with. So everything will be will be L infinity and L2 base. No other kinds of norms will appear. So for the function psi itself, I want to consider data such that up to order 4 derivatives, so grad less than or equal to 4, up to order 4 spatial derivatives in L infinity, and then, so here's the time derivative at time 0. So this is, you should think that this is a large quantity. Psi naught is a large quantity, but if I put at least one derivative on it, and no more than 3, so let me just denote this by close the brackets 1 to 3. So this is up to order 3 spatial derivatives on this function, but at least one. This is going to be small, as is, so these are L infinity assumptions. And now I want to talk about the Sobolev assumptions. So if I take grad psi and H5, so this is consistent with my claims that we're going to control the solution in H6, right? And psi naught, I'm going to put some Sobolev space assumptions on it. It's going to be an H3 of sigma naught with exactly two space derivatives on it. So these, by assumption, are going to be less than or equal to a small parameter that I call epsilon, and I put a circle over it. Because whenever I put a circle over something, it means it's associated, something you can compute in terms of the data. Okay, and in the proof, epsilon with a naught over top is going to be the thing that you choose to be very small. And every single term has at least one space derivative on it, except for psi itself. So this is consistent with the idea that space derivatives should be small, because I want to treat this equation like an ODE. And at the same time, I don't want to cheat. I don't want to start off with the coefficient being 0. So I start off with the coefficient itself being very small. And there are only two other parameters that enter into the analysis. So this is everything that's small. What's not small is psi naught itself in L infinity. Let's say that this is, let me say, equals delta. Okay. And there is an associated quantity whose significance I've already sort of alluded to several times. So, it's kind of like a variant on delta. Just want to put a star here. Okay. I want to take the max. Side remark, I didn't say it, but all of the initial data, for convenience, let's assume they're compactly supported. In a minute, we'll convince ourselves that such initial data exist, verifying all of these assumptions. Psi naught with a overhead, the negative part. Okay. So this is the what you asked earlier. Do you know when the solution blows up? Yes, I do. So remark. The time of first degeneracy. Is 1 plus order epsilon times the reciprocal of this guy. Okay, so in other words, if this were honest to God ODE, two time derivatives of psi equals zero, then it would be very easy to convince yourself that this is the time of first vanishing. Okay, we'll do that exercise later in the proof, just to be thorough. And then, why is this useful to sort of know in advance? So we're going to do a bootstrap argument. And suffices to assume, so if you know when the degeneracy is going to happen more or less, in all of your estimates, you can assume that time is less than twice the expected blowout time. Right. So you try to control the solution. You try to derive a priori estimates for this amount of time. And then in the end, that's plenty of time to show that the degeneracy happens. Okay? And if you do this, if you take this approach, then one good thing is that you can allow all of the constants, the things that you usually call C or whatever you like to call them, you can allow them all to depend on delta and delta star inverse, as long as epsilon is sufficiently small. You know, everything is sort of predetermined. You sort of know what you have to do. Okay, so by smallness. Okay. So I don't really want to give a fully technical statement about the kinds of smallness that one needs in this problem. Because it's kind of cumbersome to state, and the proof will make it entirely clear. Okay. So what you need is that, let me be a bit vague, so epsilon should be small with respect to this guy, delta star. And epsilon should be small with respect to the reciprocal of this guy. Okay. When you go to do so, let me make a further comment on the second assumption. When you go to do analysis, you'll encounter products that might look like this. One second. Okay, error terms that will look something like this. Okay, the point is this: you'll get error terms that aren't necessarily linear in what you want to call delta, okay? And you want these to be something, somehow to close the bootstrap argument, you want these to be small compared to one, say. And then if you just solve for the smallness of epsilon, this tells you that, you know, epsilon should be smaller than 1 over delta squared. And so when I say small with respect to 1 over delta, I actually mean 1 over delta squared or 1 over delta cubed or whatever the estimate requires. If you hope to close this logic, the only thing that you really have to do is to convince yourself that there exists data, there exists a set of initial data so that you know, delta star and delta are fixed, but I can take epsilon as small as I want. Okay, so that's what we're going to do now. So talk about existence of data for several reasons. First of which, to make sure we're not proving a void theorem, okay? A null theorem that has no such, where the hypotheses are never satisfied. And second of all, to compare with other results in the literature. And third of all, I want to point out that somehow, if you take arbitrary initial data that's, let's say, smooth or H6, and you rescale it in a certain way, you will always enter into the solution regime. Okay, so somehow arbitrary profiles, if you smear them out the right way, okay, will always put you in the situation. So that tells you that this kind of degeneracy for this kind of equation, you know, it really happens for an interesting class of initial conditions. Okay. So it's actually very easy to see this, that there exists such data. Okay. Let's start with arbitrary, non-trivial, smooth data. Psi not, such that the minimum of the time derivative function is negative, so such that the min is compactly supported, arbitrary compactly supported data, such that the minimum over R3, or say sigma naught of psi naught, is negative. Okay. So why negative? Well, because I want the degeneracy to form to the future. If it were positive, then you just solve backwards in time and you would prove the same theorem for negative time values. Okay, so I just want to rescale the data now. Start with your favorite profile and then rescale it. Psi of, let me call x bar the usual flat coordinates on R3. The scaling parameter, I call it lambda. For psi naught. So what are these rescaled things? Well, for psi, it's totally trivial, absolutely trivial. You just put a, so lambda is going to be huge. I'm going to take lambda to be very, very large. You just put a 1 over lambda in front of it. Okay, so obviously if you take lambda to be huge, you can make all of the pure psi stuff as small as you want in a way that doesn't have anything to do with the other data functions. Okay, that's totally trivial. And then for the psi naught, I want to not touch the amplitude. I just want to put lambda inside. Okay, so this means, so if you do this kind of rescaling, then these L infinity norms and this, so delta and delta star don't change at all, okay? Because you're not doing anything to the amplitude. You're just putting a certain scaling into the inside argument, and now you just start taking some space derivatives, and you see what happens. Okay, this is very simple, right? So if you take k space derivatives of psi lambda. Not. This is just 1 over lambda, k space derivatives. So maybe I should put that arguments, k space derivatives of lambda of psi naught, the x with a factor of 1 over lambda inherited. And of course, for the other data function, psi naught, you pick up, if you take k derivatives, you pick up a factor of minus k. Okay. So you'll start to see in 1 second when it comes to thinking about Sobolev norms why I took 2 space derivatives here. So clearly, so if I take lambda to be large, in the case k equals 1, or k equals 1, 2, and 3, I take, and for the L infinity norms, if I freeze if I freeze the profile and take lambda to be large in the case k equals 1, 2, and 3, then I can make the right-hand side as small as I want in L infinity. Right? So that means it's trivial to make this term small, and it's trivial to make this term small, and it's trivial to make this term small. Okay, all three of these terms are easy to make small. And then finally, for the last term, where I, you know, I put this assumption of two space derivatives and sign not not, you just compute the L2 norm of these guys. You take k derivatives of psi naught naught, lambda, and you put it in L2. And, you know, from the change of variables, you pick up a 3/2. Okay, so obviously if k is 2 or larger, and you look at the scaling on the right-hand side with lambda large, then you can make the L2 norm of the left as small as you want, as long as you take at least two space derivatives. And so that's exactly the statement here. Okay? So... that shows you, so I think that's the end of our construction of the initial data. What I'm saying is you take an arbitrary profile, you rescale it in this way, and you can make the space derivatives as small as you want. You can make this as small as you want just by taking lambda to be sufficiently large. Okay? At the same time, you can freeze delta and delta star, and so... at least I've convinced you, I hope, that there exists data so that you can get the party started. And tomorrow, we'll go through as much of the analysis as we can. I guess I better stop there because it's 5. Okay, I'll stop.
Yeah, so is there a qualitative difference between the p equals 1 and p equals 2 places?
Yes, so that was something I was going to harp on in detail later, but I'm very happy to say some preliminary remarks now. Okay, so what I have tried to convince you of thus far is that when, let's say the case p equals 1, at the time of first vanishing, look at any of the points where the coefficient has gone to 0. What we're going to have is a quantitative estimate about the sign of dt psi at that point. It will have become, this coefficient will have become negative because dt psi is negative. Therefore, consider any C1 extension of psi, not even a solution to an equation. Take any C1 extension of that function past the time of first degeneracy. That C1 extension, the coefficient associated to it will necessarily have become negative because it has the time derivative that has a certain sign. That means there's no hope of continuing the solution to the wave equation past that time of degeneracy. You know, the equation definitely turns strictly elliptic, no matter how you try to do it. So for that kind of equation, those points where 1 plus psi vanishes represent a point on what's called the maximal development of the data. That means there's no hope of solving the solution to the future of that point. However, for the case p equals 2, things are quite different. If you take any C1 extension of the solution, you will definitely re-enter into the regime where the solution becomes, you know, a regular wave equation again, at least at that point where the vanishing first occurred. So that leaves open the question of whether or not you can solve past the degeneracy. And that is certainly one of the open problems that I think is fascinating and for which nothing's been done. And for which I can at least tell you some very, very weak result in that direction to give you some hope that one can do something. Is
Does it happen that it would change type a lot, like as you evolve the equation psi with, I mean, the one
everything
plus psi term, but I don't know. Okay.
The only thing I know is how to solve up the T star.
Okay.
And everything's open. Even in one space dimension, if you insist on Sobolev class solutions, everything is open. Even in 1D. Okay.
Are there any more questions? All right, if not, let's thank Jared again. All right, we start again tomorrow morning.
Thank you.